Welcome, everyone. Fumi Arakawa, born in Japan, spent some transition time in Idaho, right? And spent a lot of time working with the folks up at Crow Canyon, and has focused on the Mesa Verde area, looking at how the lithic, understanding lithic procurement and distribution up in that area gives social insights into the archaeology of sort of southwestern Colorado. And he's now at New Mexico State University, running both the museum and as an assistant professor in the department there. And I think the perspectives he's bringing tonight, he's moved into working in the Mimbres area, right? As a kind of a new research area for him. But tonight, we're going to look at Eastern and Western perspectives on archaeology in the past. So I think it's going to be a very enjoyable talk, and I've assured Fumi that you are a very easy to get along with audience, and this is an informal presentation, so there will be an opportunity for conversation, so it's a good venue for you to speak here tonight. Thank you for coming, and take it away. Thanks.
Good evening, and thank you very much for inviting me to, you know, Tucson, and it has been great. I mean, Tucson is a wonderful city, and I really wish that I can actually live here. But I left Las Cruces this morning and arrived, and then while I was driving, and I wonder about why I'm presenting, you know, not like archaeology in the Four Corners area or, you know, my current research in the Mimbres region. But today, what I want to do is I just want to give you some ideas, you know, what I have been thinking about, you know, particularly the archaeological interpretation. So before talking about my talk, the title is Eastern and Western Perspectives on Archaeology and the Past. I just want to briefly introduce my background. And Bill said, I'm originally from Japan, and I have been working, you know, in the American Southwest for probably close to 20 years. And my research has been working in the Four Corners area, you know, mostly in Colorado, and then now switch the topic to the what we call the Northern Mimbres region. And as I said, I'm originally from Japan, and Japan is actually a very interesting country. And there's another audience here from Japan, so I just cannot make any stories now. But I just want to share why Japan or Japanese culture is very interesting or very different from other countries. And I think that the one major difference would be the religion. So a lot of, you know, Japanese people in Japan, they practice and exercise three different religions, including Shintoism and Buddhism, and also Confucianism and Tao. So about 10 years or 15 years ago, one Japanese broadcaster company interviewed a lot of Japanese people, and then they asked a simple question, like, what is your major religion? And then about 77% of Japanese people answered, yeah, my major religion is Shintoism. But then also about 86% of Japanese people also said that, yeah, I'm also Buddhist too. So, you know, there are probably a lot of people also practice Confucianism and Taoism as well. So they kind of practice those three, you know, different religions in their daily life. So some people say that, you know, Japanese people could be classified or identified as anthropologists because they practice, you know, multiple religions in their daily life. And going back to my background, as I said, I have been working the archaeology in the Southwest. But when I was an undergraduate student, I was very, very interested in, you know, Native American studies. And then, you know, kind of I have three different lenses, or things that I was very interested in. So as I said, and I haven't said actually, I got all my degrees, like bachelor's, master's, and PhDs from the United States. So I, have been very well trained in Western perspective, and then I totally understand how, we use logic and rationality to, think about human behaviors and human motivations. But my background still have the Eastern perspective. That's, as I said, I still practice Shintoism, Buddhism, and Confucius, and so on. And then, as I said, when I was an undergraduate student, I was very interested in Native American studies. So, I pretty much have take a look at all archaeological research or archaeological interpretation by looking at those three different lenses. So just keep in mind that. So today, what I want to do is, I just want to briefly talk about kind of Eastern and Western perspectives on archaeology and the past, and why I'm more interested in this subject, and I can provide you two reasons. One is that, some archaeologists, not only United States, but a lot of European countries, they start talking about ontology and metaphysics. So that means, talking more about philosophy. And I actually participated in one conference that's called TAG, the Theoretical Archaeological Group Conference in Boulder, Colorado last April. And a lot of archaeologists, try to kind of understand or, saying how we might be able to understand ontology and metaphysics. But, ontology is a subject of studying philosophies that is concerned with the nature of existence. And metaphysics means that part of study of, philosophies that try to explain the nature of reality and discuss whether ideas, space, life, the world actually exist. So ontology and metaphysics, philosophers and archaeologists just start try to figure out, they try to understand what is actually exist and what is actually real. So, one of my goals in this presentation is to provide some, Japanese examples to demonstrate that ontology and the metaphysics are very complex than one expects. And then another kind of goal I have today is try to kind of figure out how can we improve the archaeological interpretation. So I'm going to take a look at kind of Eastern and Western perspectives, and maybe at the end, I might be able to say something about, okay, maybe this might be a good way to kind of interpret archaeological records. So today's I hope you can see this. This is my outline. I have three major goals. Sorry about this, my ear is so small. Okay. So first, I want to briefly talk about Western perspectives and then take a look at two things. One is the casual or analytical thinking, and then also briefly talk about Western logic. Then after that, I would like to introduce some Eastern perspectives, including the correlative thinking, and then also using those two examples to demonstrate that, metaphysics and the ideas are very complex than we, usually expect. Then at the end, I just want to maybe give you some ideas how, my research, particularly in the northern members region that is in the Gila National Forest, can improve the archaeological research and archaeological interpretation. Okay, first, take a look at the Western perspective. And I should have studied more about this topic, but I didn't have enough time to actually, kind of understand or figure out, the definition of Western perspectives. But I can give you some ideas, or maybe some characteristics to define what would be a Western perspective. So in 1989, one scholar, he's a philosopher, wrote a book called The Disputers of the Tao, and the author is the A.C. Graham. And what he said was he listed three kind of major terms that maybe, help us understand and define what Western perspectives would be. And he said the analytical perspective or thinking would be a very typical Western thinking. And then he also said accurate prediction, and then also inclined to pressure of fact. And those three terms might be, need more explanations, but I'm going to just give you the basic ideas what he said. And when he tried to explain it, he used a kind of linguistic structural approach. So in other words, he used language to describe how people think about words and then sentenced. And then he used the binary oppositions. And that is, as you know, when somebody said day, and then opposite word would be night. And then if somebody said good, then you would say, evil would be an opposite meaning or opposite word. How about light? If somebody said light, what would be an opposite word? Yeah, it's a darkness. How about knowledge?
Ignorance,
yes. So according to, A.C. Graham, he thinks that, those binary oppositions, those are just, we kind of expect what kind of words we're going to say, and then those are pretty much, embedded in our brains. And then this is what he called as correlative thinking. So, people kind of predict what kind of words would be there, but when somebody said, for example, like a light, and then if somebody else said knowledge, and this does not provide a parallel or a parallelism, right? So then he argues that whenever people start kind of asking what those meaning, then people are actually conducting this casual or analytical reasoning. And then another example that, this is kind of my own interpretation, then this cannot be right, but I just want to share, when people talk about, in a Western thinking, I should have mentioned that I have a handout here. And then if you take a look at handout, there's a number on the left bottom, 1, 2, 3, 4. So please take a look at number one. Okay, so I just want to use what, we kind of know about the great chain of being. That is a very, a traditional or classic Western thought about how this world works. And Saint Augustine and his view of evil would be another example to maybe describe what Western perspective would be. And he said that evil is an accident in an Aristotle sense. So it is a privation of good. And evil is not a substance. And evil cannot exist without good, but good can exist without evil. So to evil and God, or good, sorry, the law of excluded middle does not apply. In other words, that anything must be good or bad or evil. So when, there's a hierarchical structures, as you can see on the, handout, the God on the top, angels, and the humans in the middle, and then others on the bottom. But in this kind of hierarchical structures, in a kind of based on what, Augustine said, is that humans are in the middle and then they just stay there, and then they are not correlated or not actually, you know, they are separated from others, and then this could be a good or evil. And then another example that maybe we might be able to say something about Western perspective would be the Western logic. And the definition of logic is a science that studies the principle of correct reasoning or validity. And the way of validity also emphasizes the rational reasoning. And in sociology, for example, the rationalization refers to the replacement of traditions, values, and emotions as motivators for behavior in a society that was rational, calculated one. And one of the probably great examples of Western logic would be the cost and benefit analysis or approach. Have you ever heard about this? That people usually try to figure out the human motivations and the human behavior by using very simple equation. The benefit always more or better than cost. So that this might be a one example of the rational calculation or Western logic would be associated with it. So I argue that these characteristics, such as what A.C. Graham said, and then those kind of characteristics would help us define what Western perspectives would be. And of course, the non-Western thinkers share similar traits as these characteristics as well. So I'm not totally saying, this is just exactly what Western thinking or Western thinkers think about things. So now I just want to briefly talk about the Eastern perspective. So according to A.C. Graham, he used the term the correlative thinking. And it's kind of different from this casual or analytical thinking because he defined those three terms. One is the synthetic, and another one is tell us what to approve and what disapprove of. So I already give you an example now, those binary oppositions. And if something actually fits, then we can just say, yeah, that sounds good, and it fits. So that's what he means by approve of and disapprove of. And then he also said that, this correlative thinking boasts to need for comprehensive word. And the examples I use for this, that great chain of being, and actually a lot of Eastern thinkers were people follow a similar concept, and that is what we call rokudo. If you take a look at the handout on the circle with some Chinese words in it, and this time, I'm gonna talk more about Buddhism and karma, but according to, this is my interpretation, the humans are same, it's located in the middle part, and then there are very hierarchical structures, gods, angels, and humans, animals, plants, and minerals, and non-being. But based on this hierarchical structure, I argue that, this kind of chain of, or great chain of things in the Eastern thought, people tended to correlate each layers with another. And as I said, I'm going to explain why this happened when I talked about Buddhism and then karma. So maybe this might be a best example to understand what this correlative thinking means. That is the five elements that a lot of Chinese or Eastern thinkers always kind of think about or care about in the past, today too. But those are water, fire, metal, wood, and soil. And as I said, those five elements are very important. And then what they say is the water quenching fire, and fire melting metal cutting wood, and wood digging soil, then eventually soil damming water. So as you can see, all five elements are somehow connected. So that, you know, this would be a great example to maybe understand what this collaborative thinking means. So then now I'd like to provide two examples from Shintoism and Buddhism to illustrate some differences in non-Western perspectives. And one is Shintoism. And do you know what Shintoism is? I think Dr. Inomata knows so much, but how about others? So it is the way of the gods, and this was probably developed or emerged around 6th century in Japan. And you know, in order for us to understand what Shintoism is, then we probably should know two important terms. One is animism, and then another one is the kami. And animism is the belief that natural objects such as rivers, rocks, you know, possess a soul or a spirit. And kami, those can be a spirits or essences or gods, referring to the energy generating the phenomena. So kami can be multiple forms, such as rocks, trees, rivers, animals, you know, places, and even people can be said to possess the, you know, nature of kami. So kami and people are not separated. They are actually within that same word and share in its interrelated complexity. So humans can have or have those kami. And the Shinto doctrine does not have a dogma. That means, you know, there is no founder or no sacred scripture. So there are some affirmations in Shintoism, and take a look at handout, you know, number two. I just listed some pictures of Shinto shrines and some trees. So the kami can be either tangible or intangible, and nature is sacred. And to be in contact with nature is to be close to the kami. So natural objects are worshipped as sacred spirits. And I just brought this, you know, teacup, and I don't know, you can see well or not, but as you can see, the shape or morphology of this kind of teacup is very kind of asymmetrical and irregular shape, right? But a lot of Japanese people, I believe, prefer to make and use this kind of teacup when they do tea ceremonies and drink tea. And, you know, I argue that this kind of shape and, you know, morphology of teacup is preferred by Japanese people because they kind of think or they kind of feel the nature from this object. And nature means that, you know, as you know, it's not stable, always changing, right? Climate change, environmental change, everything is not stable. And then the nature, you know, represent those kind of changes or different shapes or irregularity. So, you know, people who manufacture this pottery and then use this, actually this was made by my mom. And I don't know, she was consciously or unconsciously made this kind of shape, but she, you know, thinks that this is so beautiful. And I argued that she felt that way because she kind of, you know, close to the nature, that means she is close to the kami. So asymmetrical, irregularity, purity, aged, weathered, and so on. Those things are very important concept in Shintoism. And then also, as you know, you can see from those pictures, the landscapes in Shintoism also represent, you know, they kind of worship nature very often. So kami, supernatural presence, worshiped at the shrines. And people worship a tree, small rocks, a boulder, as you can see from those pictures. And then when you go to a Shinto shrine in Japan, you sometimes see there's a totally empty place with maybe strings or ropes surrounded there. And then people believe that actually kami or spirits actually lives there. So these examples illustrate how animistic perspectives still exist in Japan. And now, this is my favorite, talk about the Buddhism. And you know, we know that the Buddhism was founded by Siddhartha Gautama about 2,500 years ago. And today, I believe over 200 million people practice or follow the Buddhism. And synopsis, you know, what they believe is very simple. That is, life's goal is nirvana. And then some young people here, you know, please do not think that nirvana is the band, you know, played in Seattle. It's that different concept. This is a very important concept in Buddhism. So then when people practice and follow the Buddhist doctrine, they have to follow these four noble truths. And one is that the truth of suffering, the truth of the origins of suffering. So in other words, when somebody is born, then he or she already suffers. And then the truth of the cessation of suffering, the truth of the path to ending suffering. That means if you can actually remove or you know, going to a next level, then you would be end of that suffering. And when people, especially the Buddhist you know, believers, describe this word, and then they use this metaphor, this is a whale, or whales, that this actually represent you know, this word very well. And what they say is, that, you know, this world is pretty much, you know, our life or our world is stuck or within this whale. But if somebody can remove or get out of this whale, then he or she can actually relieve from the self and then go to a next level or reach to nirvana. And two terms that probably, you know, I should point it out for Buddhism, that, I mean, those two terms are important. One is karma, and then another one is transmission, or people just call it as a reincarnation. The karma is a concept that the sum total of person's actions in this and previous status of existence decided their fate in future existence. And transmission or reincarnation means that philosophically concepts that spirit after biological death can begin a new life in a new body. So there are a lot of stories about this, and then, you know, there is one story that I would like to share that is, you know, in a long time ago in Japan when somebody almost died, and then I think his wife, or he actually wrote some words in his feet. And then after he passed away, then there was a new baby was born, that the baby actually had exactly same words on his feet. So people say that the reincarnation actually took place from him to that new baby. So therefore, if one does good deeds and actions and behaviors while he or she lives now, then he, she will be moved to next level or reach nirvana. And in terms of philosophy, you know, as I said, I was interested in the ontology and the metaphysics, what actually exists, what doesn't exist. And the Buddhist doctrine is very different compared to other religions such as Jewish, Christianity, and even Islamic beliefs. And I just want to list, you know, those four terms to maybe understand why Buddhism is very different from others. One is all products are impermanent or impermanence. And I'm going to talk more about this term. But still, you know, when I took a Buddhism class when I was undergraduate, and I spent probably like, you know, couple months trying to figure out what that this mean. And then, you know, it has been like 20-something years, but I still don't understand what this means. But this concept is very, very important, or embedded in Buddhist doctrine. And all contaminated things are miserable. That means if you claim or achieve, or you try to desire or try to achieve something, then you suffer. So you should probably not achieve or claim or anything, then you won't suffer. And all phenomena are empty and selfless. So they kind of emphasize the nothingness or emptiness or selfness in Buddhism. And finally, the nirvana is peace. And it is important to note that though the neither nor dialectic relationship is very emphasized in Buddhist doctrine. That means people tend to say that neither being nor non-being exist. That phrase actually fits very well with those concepts or philosophies in Buddhism. So, the neither nor dialectic relationship is a means to persuade a thinker to stop reasoning about subject for which experience can give no answer. So in other words, neither nor explanation actually makes sense for understanding those concepts. And one of my co-authors, actually I'm working this paper with another philosopher, and his name is Michael Mayer, once said that, that Buddhist doctrine intended to eliminate completely the possibility of Western metaphysical affirmation. And logical affirmation is fine as long as it contains no ontological baggage. So then I just want to focus on this concept, the impermanence. So that concept of impermanence strongly embedded in Buddhist ontology and metaphysics. And impermanence means nothingness or emptiness, or all things are momentary and depending on a web of conditions for their arising. So everything is empty of its own permanent substance. So the belief is, as you can see, little bit or very different from other philosophies, particularly the Western ontology, because it emphasizes the existence of being in the world. So when I try to kind of understand still, this is my ideas, and it might not be right, but when I try to understand kind of Western ontology and metaphysics, people consider that being has priority over non-being. But in Buddhism, people tend to think that everything is nothing or nothingness, emptiness exists. But maybe he or she wanna understand the reality or existence, then he or she has to be live in this moment. So like this moment that you are listening to my wonderful presentation. So you kind of maybe feel or you might understand the reality and existence. But otherwise, everything is just nothing or impermanent. So since the Buddhist doctrine focuses on neither nor arguments, non-attachment and impermanence, the believers tend to follow and practice the ethical values or experiences that promote peace and compassion for others. And they believe only experiences that, they believe experiences rather than theories help people understand the reality. So how can they reach or understand the reality and the existence? I just want to briefly talk about Zen Buddhism. So Zen Buddhism is a part of Zen Zen is a part of Buddhism, right? It's a subsection or subpart of Buddhism. And that Zen Buddhism can provide their practical way of achieving their goal. And Zen Buddhism emphasizes experiences in nature. And to understand nature, the oneness is very important concept in Zen. So one can, you know, find relief from the self when one becomes one with tangible or intangible beings. And in other words, if you and I understand being, then you become one with something else. And one great example of Zen Buddhism is in the handout number 3 on the second page or flip page. You know, landscaping Zen garden would be another example. So gardening became popular with onset of Zen. In, it emphasizes fragility and also natural elements. And they believe every element has meaning and special placement. So when somebody takes care of his or her garden and lives with it, then he or she can understand reality close to nature and relief from self. So in my archaeological laboratory class, you know, what I always say is people or students who analyze pottery, shard, and flakes, those are very kind of boring things to actually analyze. But I always say that you gotta be one with those shards and also flakes. Otherwise, you might not be able to understand the reality or maybe very important meaning of those objects. So finally, I just wanna briefly talk about the cause and effect relationship in Buddhism. So in Buddhist doctrine, it emphasizes that the cause and effect relationship between things. And all actions and behaviors can be explained by this relationship, something caused and something, you know, happened. So some scholars wondered whether the cause and effect relationship would be similar to the concept of the cost-benefit analysis or approach, or rationality in social sciences, including archaeology. But I argue that the cause and effect and cost and benefit share subtle similarities, but mostly differences. In a Buddhist doctrine, the relationship between the cause and effect should be equal, but not more or less. Thus, if we use the relationship to understand human behaviors or human rationality and motivations, the equation would be the 1 equals to 1, so C equal to E. The cause and effect should be an equal relationship. But in contrast, the archaeologists, among other scholars, generally use the cost and benefit approach to understand human behaviors and motivations based on the equation that rationality of benefit should be more than the cost. So I argue that the rationality of benefit, the rational calculation of human behaviors and motivations using the cost and the benefit approach in Western logic should be approached with more cautions. And why am I saying that? I can give you 3 reasons. One, in Buddhism, the people are happy and pleased when they accomplish their goals or purposes based on cause and effect relationship. And this relationship should be equal, but not more or less. And then finally, their motivations and behaviors might not be able to calculate it using particular currencies, such as time and energy, because they focus more on good deeds or karma to eventually reach nirvana. So in other words, people do cost and benefit analysis, they have to kind of think about not only those two those currencies, but they probably got to put something else as well. So in conclusion, what I have kind of talked about, I argue that the concept of cultural or casual analytical thinking would be a great example of Western perspectives, as A.C. Graham kind of briefly talked about. Those include like analytic and also, accurate predictions and so forth. In contrast, the Eastern perspectives can be described as correlative thinking. You know, those include synthetic and also both to need for comprehensive world. So in terms of ontology and metaphysics, the Jewish and Christian thinkers consider that being has priority over non-being. In contrast, the Buddhist doctrine represents the idea of non-being and impermanence nature. So archaeologists, you know, should be at least aware that, you know, there are different ontology and metaphysics actually exist in the world. So we should probably, you know, kind of study more and maybe using more examples or more case studies, and then, you know, actually we can talk more about the ontologies and the metaphysics in archaeology. So finally, I just want to kind of state how can we actually improve the archaeological interpretation, particularly in the American Southwest. And I argue that we should implement the animistic perspectives, like the practice by Shintoists, because a lot of Native Americans were indigenous people, you know, follow and practice similar concept or belief systems. So to achieve this goal, the Western archaeologists particularly should communicate well with indigenous and Native Americans, and also we need to listen very carefully what they say and then listen to their voices. So in my case, you know, I just kind of started and planned it, but what I'm going to do in the Northern Members region is I'm going to work with some Native American artists, and, you know, those include Hopi and Zuni, and then we're going to try to kind of, you know, study about those members' pottery designs, and then what they think about, how they kind of, you know, maybe indicate some hidden meanings of those motifs. And this study actually was done by Fred Capaldi in 1987, and we just want to explore and then listen to more Native Americans' voices. But keep in mind, though, you know, I always think about this, and it's just, you know, not try to gain or try, you know, doing this research and then not try to gain only benefit for me, but I also hope that those Native American artists particularly, they can actually maybe get some ideas, and then they might be able to use those members' designs and motifs for their contemporary arts, including jewelries and contemporary pottery designs. And it is important to note that though, if Western archaeologists do not communicate with indigenous and Native Americans, they should acknowledge that they are still using Western logic, like both and also either or argument, but not the neither nor or other ways of arguments. And then second thing I want to say is we should implement the correlative thinking in archaeological interpretation. If you take a look at the figure number 4, the landscape studies, and actually I got inspired by T.J. Ferguson. I hope he's here today, but he's not. And, you know, T.J. Ferguson's studies and then also Kurt Antschu, you know, those two archaeologists have been studying landscape studies in the American Southwest, and I was pretty much inspired by their research and their goals. So what I'm saying here is, you know, maybe this landscape studies, and on the right side you see or left side where my research will take place. That is, you know, you might be able to see the star. It's in the Gila National Forest. And then what I'm gonna plan to do is, you know, try to put many layers and then try to integrate those layers together. And then each layer has different aspects such as topography and then archaeological research and archaeologist voices and Native Americans' voices. And then I try to also maybe interview the ranchers and the farmers because they might have some ideas about, you know, particular landscape. So I believe that, you know, kind of combining those many different layers, then we might be able to understand some, you know, real meanings. So something about the landscape in the northern members region. And then finally, I don't forget about this lecture series. The theme of this lecture series is connection. Is that right? I hope so. So I thought about this while I was driving, and then, you know, what I want to say is, okay, for me, I'm looking at three lenses. You know, as I said, I have pretty good Western rational reasoning, and then I have an Eastern perspective, and then now try to understand Native Americans' perspective. So that connection for me would be right here. So looking at archaeological records and interpretations by three different lenses, I might be able to understand maybe what is human nature or how those people lived in the past. And what I want to say is that, you know, maybe archaeologists, particularly working in the Southwest, you know, a lot of people have tried maybe one or two perspectives, but maybe we need more. So that means multiple perspectives would be good. And then, but, you know, if I can like restate what I say is, you know, the concept of anthropology is still important, because anthropologists always look at, you know, human behaviors, human, you know, societies by many different lenses or perspectives. So, you know, I would say anthropological perspective or anthropological archaeology is still very important for us to actually understand the archaeological research and archaeological interpretation. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Fumi. And I want to apologize to everyone. The noise balance here has been really frustrating tonight. We found out just a little while ago that we were moved inside. So I'll carry around the microphone to anyone who has questions or comments.
A young man from Japan to come over here to study and follow your career here.
So as I said, when I was an undergraduate student, I was very interested in kind of Eastern and Western perspectives. And I thought maybe I can major in, you know, those comparative studies. But the school I went to, the University of Idaho, didn't have a major, you know, such a major. So then I took a lot of anthropology classes, and I became also interested in Native American, you know, perspectives or culture. And then, you know, why I became an archaeologist, that was a kind of accident. I would like to say that I think, you know, I mean, one time, one archaeologist at the University of Idaho, he didn't have anybody to go to the field. And then, you know, I was actually kind of not interested in archaeology when I was undergraduate student, because I kind of feel that, okay, why, you know, we are dealing with the somebody's history and the cultures, particularly Native Americans' archaeological sites, and then, you know, why those Native Americans just study about them. So I kind of had some difficulties actually to be an archaeologist, but one time, the one professor actually grabbed me, and he said, we need somebody to go to the field, and then we need somebody. And then I was kind of pretty active outside. You know, when I was in Japan, I did the construction work one time, and I had those skills, and he knew that. So then he took me to the archaeological sites and then, you know, did archaeological research. But then the major kind of change or, you know, what happened to me was after I became, or I did the internship at the Crow Canyon Archaeological Center, pretty much changed my perspective, and I pretty much decide to be archaeologist. And why that happened? Because as some of you here know, the Crow Canyon, you know, kind of consists of three or four different components. One is archaeological research, and then teaching archaeology using archaeological records or documents. And then they also have Native American involvement. So those three things just worked so well for me. And then I thought, yeah, you know, if we do that, then archaeology actually works. So then I actually became an archaeologist after that. And then also the Ben Bellato here, he and I worked at the Crow Canyon together, and then he inspired me too. You gotta buy me a beer. Yeah. Sorry. Cut.
So if you had stayed in Japan, yes, and gotten your 3 degrees in Japan and were doing archaeology in Japan, would your interpretations be even more framed by Buddhism and Shintoism and the things you've talked about as an Eastern perspective? Is that how Japanese archaeologists who work in Japan, is that how it's framed, or is it framed in a Western perspective, scientific, whatever that means, perspective?
I know about Japanese archaeology just a little bit. You know, some archaeologists I know there has got, you know, degrees in the U.S., so I kind of know their work. But other Japanese archaeologists in Japan, they do some like a rational or rationalization of archaeological interpretation, of course, but they might have some other perspective as well. I gotta read more about Japanese archaeology. Sorry, but maybe, do you wanna say something?
Here comes the other perspective on Japanese archaeology.
Much to say, but I just have some questions. I have one question. Thank you for this very interesting talk, and then this contrast between the West and the East is really interesting. But the West, Western way of thinking that you talk about is based on this Judaism, Islam, or Christianity. Those are pretty much coming from the same roots. And then even in Europe, before Christianity, like a rule, Greek thinking was very much like animism and the polytheistic, yeah, and God, the human can be a God. Mm-hmm. Then the world was very much like those non-Western thinking, not just the East, the Native American that you talk about, and yes, Africa, Asia, all those places. But when you contrast to the West, it looks like the one way of thinking. But when we compare Native Americans, Eastern thinking, or Japanese thinking, or those Indian thinking, they're very different.
Yeah.
Then I was wondering how you think about this difference, more specific way of thinking between, including differences between Japan, India, or China, or Native Americans, or other places of the world?
Yeah, that is an excellent question. So if I understand your question, maybe generalizing the Japanese or Eastern perspective would be many different ways to look at, you know, not only Japan, but also China, India, and then those things. And actually, A.C. Graham, he talked about how those actually separation took place. And then he said the proto-science, you know, that is very embedded in yin and yang cosmology in China. And that came from Taoism and Confucianism. And what he said is that he asked the basic questions, why, you know, Chinese people didn't develop those, you know, more like a rational or scientific methods. even though they could do it, because they innovated, you know, gunpowder. You know, they also had, I mean, not only China, but India, or people in India, had the numerical systems and everything. But he argued that because of this correlative thinking, that means, you know, the yin and yang and relationship, cosmology, they also have, you know, four directions and four seasons. And then that just below that, there are five other elements, including, you know, five senses, five touches, and five sounds, and so forth. And then they also have 16 or 64 different kind of things. So those things are actually correlated. And then people, you know, I think there are, especially people in China, people who follow this correlative thinking, just kept this structure. And then they didn't kind of ask to, you know, explore to explain or develop the, you know, like logic and then other way of, you know, those things. That's what I kind of understand. And then I know that my generalization of Western and Eastern perspectives should be simplified because I just gave you the big pictures. And I really hope that, you know, working with the real philosopher, his name is Michael Mayers at the Washington State University, and he kind of knows about how we might be able to compare the East and the West. And I just, you know, that when I actually put all PowerPoints or those presentations, that was my just ideas first. And then I send my draft to Mike Mayers, the philosophers, and he said, yeah, those are good ideas, but you need more details. And then, you know, I actually needed more weeks or months to prepare this, but I just, you know, wanted to give the big or general ideas about what would be the Western and the Eastern perspectives. So, sorry, I don't know, I answered your question or not. Yes.
I'm following up on Takeshi's idea about variability. Let's move from Eastern and Western to Native American. And one of the things about somebody who spent most of his career working in the Southern Southwest, where they're often in the area I work in, there's no clear historical connection between modern groups and the archaeological populations. I'm always concerned that the default ethnographic Native American perspective is always the Pueblos.
Yeah.
And you're going to have the Hopi and the Zuni, and I think that's great, but why not look at and Apache?
Yeah.
I mean, they may not be historically connected
to
the Mimbres. On the other hand, neither are Eastern perspective, the Chinese or the Japanese. And so I always kind of bristle that the ethnographic default for the Southwest are the Northern Pueblos.
Yeah.
And really, people need to expand far beyond that.
Yeah. And then speaking of the, you know, many different tribal groups, and this kind of landscape studies, what I'm proposing is including many different tribes as well. So when we actually conduct the, you know, landscape studies in the northern members, I'm going to work with Apache, you know, Mascarero, and other Apache groups, and then also Pueblos, and then, you know, other groups, and then just try to figure out what they say about the landscape, not only one tribe. And that is pretty much, I got inspired by T.J. Ferguson's, you know, work in this area.
I was just wondering, you know, coming from the background that you have and up in the north, and we work with a lot of folks that do a lot of behavioral ecology, and that kind of struck me as your cost benefit. Maybe it would fit in there. So I was wondering how this great new perspective or this integration of other perspectives could potentially change some of those interpretations of just, you know, corn farmers relating to climate, relating, you know, how do some of these other factors come in?
So you're asking like human behavioral ecology, how can they improve?
Well, just how this perspective might change the traditional behavioral ecology kind of outlook.
So I would say it's kind of, you know, going back to the correlating thinking. So maybe they can add more layers instead of just one, you know, component or layer. So they might be able to understand or put, you know, more things, and then they might be able to improve it. And honestly, I did human behavioral ecology for my dissertation and other things. But now, you know, I got tenure and I can do anything I want to. So I'm going to try kind of explore the new ideas, and then maybe I can contribute something, you know, to the American Southwest, because, you know, Pat Gilman and other people saying that, you know, we probably need more ideas and perspective, especially in the American Southwest.
The idea of bringing multiple perspectives together is, it's really well developed in literary theory, and it's starting to breach over into social science and historical research. And in literary theory, they call it multi-perspectivity or polyperspectivity. Mm-hmm. And in your opinion, do you think that as we move into this area of research in social science, it's sufficient to just present the different perspectives, is what's going on today? Or is it imperative on us to find an essential similarity amongst the perspectives? And in your Venn diagram, you show that shaded area. Mm-hmm. And so are you really getting at trying to find this core essence of knowledge or being, or
just describing each layer and then put
exactly
together?
And if we are to move into finding that commonality, how do we go about that without denigrating the parts of the perspectives that maybe don't blend?
Yeah. So, you know, what I'm thinking about it is probably finding the commonality would be very productive or a very good way to understand, you know, what happened in a particular landscape. And that might be, you know, maybe very difficult things to do. But if we have common goals, such as I said, if, you know, do a research with like Native Americans, I haven't done it, but I'm gonna try to do in the future. And if we have common goals and the common things that we can get benefit, not only me, but for the Native Americans and the other researchers, we might be able to find some, you know, things that maybe we can share. So for example, Ben and other people at the Crow Canyon did the farming project, you know, with Hopi farmers. And then that, you know, farming project, you know, has been very successful because, you know, archaeologists are interested in that topic, but also the Hopi farmers are, you know, also interested in that, how those people actually cultivated the corn in the past. So, you know, what I'm saying is, you know, when we do research with those indigenous or Native American peoples, if we can have similar goals, and then, you know, we can get the similar benefit, then we might be able to find something that maybe everybody share. For example, water. You know, if we ask a same or a question about water, how water, you know, people use in the past, and asking like Apache, maybe Pueblo groups, or ranchers today, or farmers today, they might have different perspectives, but, you know, we are talking about same theme, that is water. So then we might be able to kind of find that commonality. So what kind of questions, and then what, you know, each person can gain from the research, I think then maybe we might be able to find something similar thing.
Fumi, thank you very much for this wonderful talk.